Thank you, Vita, for the introduction, and thanks to anyone who's left to listen to me now today. So I work in the emergency department of the Midland Regional Hospital in Tullamore, and I also have a sessional commitment in Mullingar. And I went on maternity leave in 2016, and when I came back in September 2016, I found out I was on the sepsis committee. So that's how I got involved. But I always had an interest in sepsis and presented at Grand Rounds about sepsis back in 2013, at which point I spent a lot of time convincing people about SIRS plus infection equals sepsis. While I was on mat leave, I read about the sepsis 3 definitions, and I thought, well, that's just great, you know. So anyway, the background to this is we were asked to be involved in the pilot of the new sepsis screening forms. And I was delighted to be asked and keen to get involved because, like I'm sure many of you who've been using the current forms, the old forms, there was some resistance, particularly at medical level, to the forms, in that, you know, they're too sensitive, we're picking up too many patients that aren't all that sick, we're prioritising young, healthy people who are just a little bit sick over potentially more severely ill patients. And I also thought it was time that I got to grips with the sepsis 3 definitions as well. And I wanted my department to be part of the input into the new national form. So when we agreed that we'd look at the piloting the forms, then we started to think, well, isn't this a good opportunity to actually audit what's happening as well? Because we're going to track these forms. We're going to track the doctors and nurses who are using these forms. And it gives us the chance to look and see what our practice is like at the moment. We had done our quarter one and quarter two audits the previous year, but it had been several months since we'd done any audit work. So it was a good chance to get involved in this. So by default then, it actually evolved into a quality improvement process because I took the opportunity very early in the audit to have a look at what our preliminary results were and realised fairly quickly that we needed to do some more work on this. So the first thing we did before we introduced the pilot of the forms, we did multidisciplinary training. So this involved a lot of the nursing staff and the majority of our medical staff, consultant, registrar and SHO. So in our department, all the NCHDs go through sepsis training at induction when they take on the post. And similarly, we would cover it in teaching at some of our kind of MMM, morbidity mortality rounds as well. So we got very good attendance at those training sessions, and Karen, who's our group aide-on for sepsis, came along to facilitate a lot of those. And we did kind of 5 or 6 different sessions to get everyone covered, but we did achieve good attendance at those training sessions. So we picked a date that we were going to start piloting the forms. We had a system whereby we numbered all the forms. We had a specific number of forms in the department, so they're the only ones that were going to be used, and we removed all the old sepsis forms. We had stickers and triage that had the number to correspond with each of the forms, and we thought, right, this is going to be great, off we go. We're all organised, this is fantastic. So I went off to a conference for a couple of days, came back to the department after a few days and decided I'll just have a look and see how things are going on this. And so I looked at the first 15 patients that we'd entered into the audit. So my very simple system of sticker with a number one on it, form with a number one on it, correlate them, match them up, but you know that this is going to work out. Number one will be on the patient card, I'll be able to find them easily. That kind of went a little bit haywire. It might have been form number one was in patient number two, form number four was in somewhere else. So things were a little bit all over the place. And also, even though we had done all the training and we had told our doctors and our nurses, you know, quite specifically, we are going to look at all these forms. We're going to follow them up and check them all out. I thought that even with the Hawthorne effect, that everything was going to be great, but actually it didn't work out quite as well as that. So we reviewed what was going on, and then we went back and did a bit of feedback and targeted intervention. So that's kind of a nice way of saying a good kick in the you-know-what for some people. And for other people, it was very much, look, I'm not quite sure if you get what we're doing with these new definitions, or if you understand when I said I wanted you to sign the form, I really wanted you to sign the effing form. So basically, that's the way it went. So, you know, not in so many words, but also for some people, it was like that. Where everywhere was persistent offenders. But for the odd one, it was just, look, you know. And also, I went back to people who were doing it very well. I said, thank you so much. You know, this is the right way to do it. Would you mind just, you know, showing that to your colleagues when you're on duty with them as the registrar? Would you mind making sure the SHOs do the same thing? Or to the nursing staff, if, you know, to the shift leaders ever, just can you just, you know, feedback to the triage nurse, that is fantastic. That's exactly the way we'd like it to happen, and maybe try and ameliorate things with some of the weaker performers. So in the second phase then, we looked at 25 patients. We saw some improvements in certain things and not so much in others. And that gave us an opportunity to further review and reflect on our situation. So what we focused on looking at our system was really on the process. So it used to kill me when I go along to sepsis committee meetings, and the very nice lady from Hype would be there, and she'd say, there's no forms. There's no forms in the chart. And the other thing to say is they're not signed. So if there was a form, they weren't signed. So nothing, it didn't seem like we were getting that right at all. So I just wanted to have a look and see where we actually signing the forms, where the form is actually getting from the ED to the chart, because I would know for sure that the form had been started on this particular patient, so we could track and see, was it in the chart. The clinical things we looked at then was the time to... Sorry, the things that we looked at, is the form signed? So for me, I mean, obviously, it's important from the coding and the diagnostics point of view that the form is signed in terms of the money the patient, the hospital will get. But also, I think it's really important as a sense of responsibility for taking responsibility for your decision that, yes, this is sepsis and I'm going to treat it as such, or no, this is not sepsis and I'm coming off the form, or I know it's just infection. So I just think it shows a responsibility and attention to detail that we should all be striving for. So the clinical things looked then were the time to antibiotics, then the evidence of review of investigations, and particularly with the new sepsis 3 definitions, it was essential that there was some evidence of review of investigation, because you have to have either clinical or biochemical evidence of organ dysfunction. And then I want to see where our doctor is actually documenting a diagnosis, be it sepsis, infection, or septic shock. So we looked at 40 patients, 15 in phase 1 and 25 in phase 2. I was able to find the ED cards on all those 40 patients and the hospital charts on 38 of the 40. And 22 of the 40 had a working diagnosis of sepsis in the ED. And some of those, that working diagnosis would have been written before the results were available, but that would have been what we would have been doing at the time. We do act on a working diagnosis a lot of the time in the emergency department. Eight of the 40 were noticed as having infection of various etiology, and the other 10 then had a mix of different things. Some of them were not infection related, and the forms were appropriately stopped at that point. So in our hospital, it was standard procedure that if the form was commenced, sepsis screening form was commenced, then it should be photocopied and a copy kept in the ED card, and then the original would go into the hospital chart. That was the first thing I wanted to focus on, was where is the sepsis form? So in the first phase, for 45% of the patients, there was a copy in the ED card. And there was about 65% of patients did have an original in their hospital chart. So certainly it did appear that some of the forms were going missing at some point along the way. When we did our kind of target intervention after phase one, essentially in terms of the clerical thing, it was just speaking to the clerical manager in the emergency department, who fed back to the reception staff and clerical staff about photocopying the form. So following that intervention, we got up to over 70% compliance with that part of the pathway. We did find that we still didn't have all the originals going into the hospital chart, or if they had gone into the hospital chart, that somewhere along the process they had been removed, or they had been lost, or maybe they were just put in and not actually filed properly. Because I found 37 of the 40 patients that we looked at, I found their sepsis screening form somewhere, either in the ED chart or in ED card or in the hospital chart. So at some point along the way, there was a the forms are getting lost at different phases. So that's something that we need to look at. The next question was, is the form signed? So in phase one, 55% of the forms were signed. So essentially, it was 8 out of the 15 forms were signed in phase one. And in phase two, following the kind of the interventions where we spoke to different people, sent out an email to everybody telling them what The results so far were we spoke at the kind of, you know, safety huddles at handover, at the end at shift change, just to remind people about the forms and how what we want to do with them. So our signature rate did increase then to nearly 80%, but still not exactly where we'd like it to be, but it was an improvement. So in terms of the timeliness of antibiotics then, so we improved the percentage that were receiving antibiotics within the 60 minutes from 71% to 83%. And we knew from the previous audits we'd done in the emergency department that we'd, I think we were around kind of 67% in the previous audits. We are showing improvements as time goes on. And hopefully we will continue to do that. There are some outliers there and within the range. You see some patients getting are delayed to like 137 minutes, 140 minutes, and those are the ones we really need to work on as well. But I was happy that there was some improvement coming through. For the evidence of review of investigations, and I took this as somebody writing down the blood results or the chest x-ray results, or a person signing off all the organ dysfunction list on the sepsis form, or using the SOFA score as evidence of review of their investigations. And this improved from about 63% to 92% in the second phase of the audit. So I was that was quite a pleasant surprise to get that kind of a result. And so they were the main things that we looked at. So in terms of the things that I learned from doing this, first of all, it's really time-consuming. It takes a lot of personal time, both for myself and from the CNM3 in the department. I was ringing the ED, saying, on Good Friday, I was off. And I just give them a ring to say, please tell me you're doing those sepsis forms that I've numbered and stickered. And they're like, no, I can't find them. I was like, oh, God. So, and then, you know, they were found. I told them where they were, and they were found, and it was fine. But it was really good even for them to be able to like, when I was looking at the ED cards, the patient was still on the ward being treated for their infection or their sepsis. So I could go up 2 or 3 days after they'd been in the ED, and you can tell straight, you know, you can say, I know at that time point the sepsis form was there in that chart. So and even it was much easier to get the cards and to get the charts if you just do it all in real time. If you can feedback to somebody very quickly about problems in their management, they can change your practice quickly as well, and they'll actually remember the specific patient that you're talking about. So that was really helpful, but it does take up a lot of time. And definitely that individualised targeted training is effective, and that's where I think that we probably do need to focus some of our efforts. It is not possible to convince everyone that to use the form. I think we're not going to get to 100% compliance without it being a jailable or maybe a deductible from your salary type thing if you don't do them. But but certainly we can bring a lot of people along with us if we are believers in them. And I love the form. I use it. I can't understand when people are diagnosing sepsis on the chart that they wouldn't just sign the form. So but anyway, it's my role to try and understand that more and help bring people along with me. So you do need help with education, with audit, and with giving feedback. And I think it's really essential that is multidisciplinary across the nursing, medical, and the clerical staff. And to give praise where it is due for some people who are working very hard to do this right. And bearing in mind that they're dealing with lots of other patients who don't have sepsis, and have lots of other things going on with them as well. So it's just funny when you were talking about the carrot and stick earlier on, or how to incentivize people. It is really quite difficult. I mean, that one for all voucher, that's one I did a one for all voucher for a frailty screen I wanted done at one stage. So whoever did the most screens got a one for all voucher, but I can't actually do that for every presentation that comes through. And that just do it. That actually would be definitely, from my point of view, I'm sorry, I have Tourette's, is just effing do it. They got that a lot for me. And for me, I mean, this definitely from my point of view, it is the patient stories. And I could put pictures up today of Sarah or Niamh. So you've got Savita and Rory there. They are the most important things, really. And it's trying just to make people remember that it's real patients that you're talking about each time. So I've tried the carrots, tried a bit of the verbal stick, and it could be a physical stick when I go back and do this audit the next time. But that's kind of where we're at. And just one last thing. So what we're going to do in the future then, so we're going to review current practice in the ED, and that fills me with fear, because we have a lot of new doctors who did the induction training, but they aren't the same doctors that I did the last audit with. So, you know, God knows what our results are going to be like. And again, it's to increase the focus on the sepsis 3 definitions, particularly for the triage nurse, so they can stop putting up the relatively well tonsillitis as a sepsis case. And again, just explore the barriers to correct use of the screening form, because you can do all the training you want, and we trained everyone, and we reiterate to everyone, and there are just some people who just don't like using forms. So thank you very much for your attention. So, happy to take any easy questions.
Hi, Anna. Lovely presentation, thank you. The old form used to ask for a lot of test results. And from my own clinical experiences, that I'd see the patient, start the form off, do my sepsis 6, and then I would hand the patient over to the medical team or whoever that I wanted to come and see the patient. And you'd get on to your next patient, and then you'd forget to go back and check the results, forget to sign the form. Do you think that because the form is simpler, that it makes it easier for people to sign the initial condition to see the patient?
I think that the form makes it easier to sign up to several points, and it's easier to come off it. And there's also space in the form where you can write that you've handed over at section 5. So, I mean, there are some patients who it is so obvious that they're not going home. You don't need to have their blood results. So you go on and you make your referral at that point, but there is a part in the form where you can state, you know, I've handed over before my results are back. And that's all I want people to do. You know, it's just, you know, recognize that there are results pending and somebody's going to check them, and that's the person who's going to check them, or I'm going to check them myself, whatever it's going to be.
Yeah, I think so. This is going to be a great help. Thank you.
Yeah. Right. Okay. Yes. Thanks very much.